Good morning, and welcome to our 12th Sunday after Pentecost. Do take a moment to place yourselves in the presence of the Lord as we hold our worship this morning. Our songs today can be found in your worship booklet. Some of our songs are found in our printout, the Teze book, and also our blue hymnal. Our song this morning to open our worship is a Teze, Sing Out My Soul, found in your worship booklet, number 45, Sing Out My Soul. And we'll sing the English words. And as you are able, please take a moment to rise and extend a warm welcome to those around you.
Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Almighty God, you know all our thoughts and desires. There is nothing we can hide from you. Enter our hearts today, and by your Holy Spirit, help us to truly love you as we glorify your name.
Amen. Amen.
God who saves me, trusting Him I shall not fear. For the Lord defends and shields me, and His saving love is near. So rejoice as you draw water from salvation's living spring. In the day
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, O merciful God, that your church, being gathered together in unity by your Holy Spirit, may show forth your power among all peoples, to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for the telling of the stories of our faith.
Our first lesson is from Exodus, chapter 1, verses 8 through chapter 2, verse 10. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramses, for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shiphrah and the other Puah, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, kill him. But if it is a girl, she shall live." But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this and allowed the boys to live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews, you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son. And when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this nurse child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses because, she said, "I drew him out of the water." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Our psalm today is Psalm 124. Your response to the psalm is, "Our help is in the name of the Lord," and I invite you to respond with that after every two verses. If the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel now say, if the Lord had not been on our side when enemies rose up against us, our help is in the name of the Lord. Then would they have swallowed us up alive in their fierce anger toward us. Then would the waters have overwhelmed us and the torrent gone over us. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Then would the raging waters have gone right over us. Blessed be the Lord. He has not given us over to be a prey for their teeth.
Our help
is in the name of the Lord. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
Our help
is in the name of the Lord.
The second lesson is from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body, we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we, who are many, are one body in Christ. And individually, we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God. Our song before the gospel is a Teze song. The Lord is my light, found in your worship booklet, number 36. The Lord is my light.
Trust in God, I trust.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you, Lord Christ. Good morning, everyone. This morning we have some of the most powerful and foundational scriptures in our entire Bible. This story that happens in Exodus, beginning with Moses and the bulrushes and on through Moses' calling at the burning bush, and then the story of the Exodus and the parting of the sea and so on, are foundational to all of Judeo-Christian history. In fact, Jesus had to have been, and his disciples, very influenced by this story. It was the story that they retold every year during the Passover. And in fact, it would have been the story that happened to be retold on the week that Jesus was crucified. The story in the Old Testament this morning is full of women, which is rare to see stories of women who are sort of the pivot and the most important people in the story in terms of what they make happen. The story of these midwives, Shiphrah and Puah, of Pharaoh's daughter, and of Miriam, as well as her mother. They are fighting against genocide, which, if you thought that was something new or 20th century or 19th century, no, it's been around since the beginning of time. And in fact, if you read all the way back to Genesis 43:32, you begin to see the beginning of the Egyptians feeling prejudice against the Hebrews or the Israelites when Egyptian refuses to sit down and eat with an Israelite. And whatever it is that Joseph is able to do to convince the people in his time to agree that the Hebrews are worthwhile people to have around, it gets undone again when Pharaoh forgets who Joseph was and begins to oppress the people. The order in which things happen in this genocidal story is basically something that we have seen happen over history in terms of first you oppress them, you make them work, and then on and on until you ask for some of them to be murdered. So Pharaoh here is asking for the firstborn sons to be murdered. Something similar happened to Jesus and his family when they escaped back to Egypt and Herod was king. And if it weren't for these women in this story, using whatever they had, which really wasn't much, we wouldn't have this story of the Exodus to look back to, which is foundational to our identity as Christians. So Shiphrah, Puah, Pharaoh's daughter, Miriam and her mother, they all have a certain amount of power, but not very much. Perhaps Pharaoh's daughter has the most power in the story. She's using her station to allow herself to adopt this child, Moses, and raise him up. But certainly the midwives had no power, and other than the power to help someone give birth, which is quite powerful, really. And Miriam didn't have much power other than the power to sort of convince people to do something that was a bit dangerous. So this story in the Old Testament this morning is a story of, in the words of our lessons that we teach the children, a story of compassion, cunning, and courage. Sometimes compassion has to be matched by cunning and courage when the situation has become dire. What I love about Shipra and Pua in particular is that even though they have very little power, they sort of use their knowledge that Pharaoh both probably underestimates women and also that Pharaoh hates the Hebrews to convince him in his prejudice that, oh, the Hebrew women, we can't get there quickly enough. We don't even know how it is that they managed to have their baby so quickly. They're vigorous. And Pharaoh doesn't question whether or not this is true, although almost surely it's not true. We know that women have all different women from, it doesn't matter what your background is, women are different. And some women will give birth easily, some will have a harder time, and particularly after you've had one child, it's easier to give birth to another. So they're able to convince Pharaoh because they're using what they know about him, his prejudice against women and against the Hebrews, to convince him that they can't help it. They just can't get there fast enough to murder the Hebrew boy babies. Meanwhile, Miriam and her mother have managed to get Moses into a basket 3 months after he was born. And Miriam very carefully follows the basket, making sure that it arrives down the Nile at Pharaoh's daughter's house. Imagine her courage and the way in which she must have held her breath in wondering whether or not Pharaoh's daughter would have helped her. But we don't know. Perhaps she had met Pharaoh's daughter before. But Pharaoh's daughter also has courage. She's decided, and she obviously has a very strong moral compass, she's decided that her father is wrong to be wanting to murder the Hebrew boy babies. And so, between all of these women who might have been seen to be powerless, their courage and their conviction makes it possible for us to have Moses bring the people out of Egypt, out of slavery, and for us to have met our Savior Jesus, who comes from the Jewish people and who practiced the festival of freedom in a fundamental way and taught his disciples to practice it too. Now, one of the things that we don't always pay attention to, but that Pharaoh knew, was that there were enough Hebrews there in Egypt that they could have done an uprising, a violent uprising, and have left Egypt with violence. During Jesus' day, people were hopeful that Jesus might be a kind of Messiah who would do the same thing. But Jesus' way, the way of these women, is not a violent uprising, but rather a kind of behind the scenes, cunning and courageous way of finding freedom in the world, which is very consistent with what Jesus taught all of his disciples. Think about that for a minute. Although we're certainly not in a time and age where we are seeing genocide, although we certainly do see prejudice in our world around us, what are the ways in which the things that we do might be violent instead of nonviolent? What are the ways in which we could talk about freedom for all people in a way that is not violent, but which is courageous? Has there been a time in your life where you have felt particularly courageous? I wonder if during that time in your life you could think back, what is it that made you so courageous in that moment? Was it conviction? Was it a sense that there was no turning back? Was it a strong belief in a power of something that was greater, perhaps in Jesus, or perhaps in something that you believe in very strongly? In following our Lord and Savior, who was one of the Jewish people and who followed that festival of liberation and freedom, there will be times in our lives where we are called to courageous nonviolence, where we are called to fight for those who are oppressed, to prevent any kind of prejudice and genocide, which takes a kind of slow path. Our God is the God of liberation and freedom. Now, in our New Testament story, when we're hearing Jesus talk to his disciples, he says, "Who does everyone else say that I am?" And they answer him, "Maybe you're a prophet. Maybe you are one of the prophets come back from the dead, or you're a teacher." They have many different answers. But Jesus turns to the disciples and says, "No, who do you say that I am?" And our scriptures invite us this morning to think about that. Who do you say that I am? Now, brothers and sisters, if you know me very well, you might know that I think of Jesus as kind of a radical, compassionate freedom fighter. I believe that that's what he was. He wanted to invite everyone to the table. He believed in the welcome table. He wanted to make sure that everyone had a place. But each of us gets to ask that question too, and to ask Jesus to be our reason for courage. Each one of us, no matter where we are, no matter what our station, if our station is high, like Pharaoh's daughter, or low, like the midwives, or Miriam, or her mother, each of us is given a God-given courage that God would hope that we might use in the world. And so in our answer to who is Jesus, each one of us have to answer that question for ourselves. That's why Jesus says, "Who does everyone else say that I am? But who do you say that I am?" I would invite you this week to consider who it is that you follow, who it is that you believe Jesus is, and to take courage in following him into the ways of freedom and life. Life being something absolutely fundamental that God wants to sustain. Steve Garnes Holmes talks about the courage that God gives us in this way. Be a good steward of the courage you are given. Befriend your fear, your faithful companion. Wise challenger, bear it up as a shield in battle. Offer up a generous burnt offering of your security and your comfort. You needn't push yourself, simply follow the spirit that leans forward in you. Submit to the sun rising in you. Dare to be the tattered dandelion, nothing left but wispy seeds, floating on the unknown, the divine wind. Holy God, God of Miriam and Shipra and Hua and Pharaoh's daughter and Moses' mother, God of Jesus and Peter and all of the disciples, Lord God, whom we follow, God of liberation and freedom, we thank you for the people we have known whose courage reminds us that your compassion is present and at work in our world. Following their lead, may we fight against systems and practices of domination, conforming only to the spirit of your justice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light,
true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world.
Holy Spirit, teach us.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Holy Spirit, guide us. Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Holy Spirit, show us. Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Holy Spirit, lead us. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them the courage and hope to sustain them in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. Holy Spirit, help us. We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Holy Spirit, embrace us. We invite your prayers for those whom you love and those who need God's love.
Dean asks for prayers for Clyde and Kay today, as Clyde has throat problems and extra prayers are needed. Tanya asks for prayers for Carol and family, as Chuck passed on to his reward this past week. Catherine asks for prayers for her friend Jody, whose mother died last Monday. Marilyn asks for prayers for her brother Rick, as he continues to recover from a stroke, and her cousin Chris, as he undergoes cancer treatment. Linda asks for prayers for Ron's nephew, Paul, who was released from the hospital and is being taken care of at home. Linda asks for prayer for her friend, Deanne, who has been diagnosed with the COVID virus. Nisha asks for repose of soul for her grandmother, Karen. John asks for prayers for Chris, Sam, and Dre, for our brothers and sisters fighting against injustice, and for our president to find wisdom. Amanda asks for prayer for continued recovery from the storm in Iowa and Illinois. asks for her prayers for her grandmother, Nita Rose, and for her friend, Jennifer Small, who is still undergoing chemo. Catherine asks for prayers for firefighters. Sherry asks for prayers for Leah as she starts her next chapter of her life at Embry-Riddle, and for Catherine and Alexi enjoying their time together as Alexi continues in high school. Laura asks for prayers for all who are affected by the California fires and the hurricanes in the south. Mel asks for prayers for Abby. Sherry asks for prayers for all those who have lost loved ones to COVID. Students, educators, and families starting school. I ask for prayers for the Kent School District and the teachers to come to an agreement on their contract. Joyce asks for prayers for Deanna and her family for the loss of her father, Jim Long.
Your prayers of thanksgiving. What are you grateful for?
Carola asks for prayers for officers as they continue to protect us during these extra difficult times. Asks for prayers for Walt and Kelly, who are going through chemo. John gives thanks to live in such natural beauty, for the beautiful music and the possibility in this day. He's also thankful for family. Dean asks for prayers for Cheryl. Molly is giving Thanksgiving for their 40th anniversary today. Mary is giving thanks for the wisdom and skills of our building committee. Grateful for the congregation and for the ability to continue to come together even when staying distant. Sherry is giving blessings to Michael and thankful for celebrating his birthday this week. Dale is grateful for the great people in this community who work so hard on behalf of others. Carola is thankful for family, friends, and her St. George family. Diane is grateful for 2 years of marriage with Michael. She feels truly blessed. Laura is thankful and grateful for all of the individual gifts we share with our community and the world. thankful for family. Jean is thankful for her children and grandchildren.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
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 Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Amen.
May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace of the Lord be with you. Brothers and sisters, walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and a sacrifice unto God.
And as the table is being prepared, please join me in singing Ubi Caritas, found in your Spirit and Songbook number 2 or your worship booklet.
Thank you.
espera, espera. Deus ibi es, Deus ibi es. The love of Christ joins us together. Let us rejoice in Him and in our love and care for all. Now love God in return. Ubi caritas espera. Espera, Deus ibi est, Deus ibi est. In true communion let us gather, may all division cease, and in their place be Christ the Lord, our risen Prince of Peace. Ubi caritas. Espera, espera, Deus ibi est, Deus ibi est. May we gather at this table to share the bread of life, become a sacrament of love, your healing touch, O Christ. Espera, espera, Deus ibi est, Deus ibi est. For those in need, make us your mercy. For those oppressed, your might. Make us your church, a holy sign of justice and
our prayers this morning continue with a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being. Sun, moon, and stars, earth, wind, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways, but we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. glory and honor and praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death and to reveal the riches of your grace. You looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with friends. He took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." When supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. And in the fullness of time, bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. George, and all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God, holy things for holy people. Amen.
And our song as we process in communion is number 195 in your Spirit and Songbook, number 1, On Eagle's Wings, number 195.
Shine like
The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation.
For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up as you dash your foot against a stone, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings.
Let us pray in thanksgiving for this time of communion which we have shared with one another. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior.
Amen. Amen.
Some special blessings this morning for those of you who are celebrating a birthday and those of you celebrating anniversaries. I saw several of them in the chat this morning. For those of you who are celebrating a birthday, Holy God, we praise and thank you for the wonderful idea you had when you made these your children. We pray that you would continue the good work that you have begun in them, bringing blessings into their lives that they may be a blessing in the lives of those whom they meet. And we pray in thanksgiving for the gift of love that you have begun and filled in these couples in our congregation. We pray that you would continue to fill their cup with love as a chalice overflowing, that their lives together may be a sacramental sign of your love for the world. And Holy God, we praise and thank you for the wonderful idea you had when you made each and every person of courage. We pray that you would bring blessings into their lives as they are a blessing in ours. Brothers and sisters, may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God, Almighty Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and those you love, both the living and the dead, this day, this night, and forevermore. Amen. Amen.
And the Tese hymn to send us forth is In the Lord. In the Lord I'll be ever thankful. Not in your worship booklet.
Brothers and sisters, our worship is over. Our service has just begun. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.